So I bought the Instant Pot. I didn't really think I needed one, but I cave into peer pressure. The question I'll try to answer in this video is the one I get asked an awful lot in classes. Should I buy the Instant Pot? I wish I could just tell you a straightforward yes or no, but it really depends on what you cook. I spent the last 2 months testing this contraption relentlessly, so I have a lot of information to share with you. Hopefully by the end of this video, you'll be able to make an intelligent decision on whether you should buy an Instant Pot, a stovetop pressure cooker, or neither. I've never owned a rice cooker, and I didn't think it was worth the space on the counter. But Instant Pot changed my mind. Sure, I can make rice on the stovetop, but I have to watch it closely so that as soon as the steam starts to escape from the lid, I turn it down to really low heat. And then I have to time it twice, once for the cooking time and once for the resting time. And I need to plan pretty well so that the rice does not cool off by the time I finish cooking the rest of the meal. In the Instant Pot, it takes one button and I am done. It will take care of cooking, resting, and keeping the rice warm until I'm ready for it. What can I say? I am hooked. The rice setting works great for white rice, quinoa, and buckwheat. For brown rice, I use high pressure, so I use the manual pressure cooking setting. It's a few more buttons, but all of them happen up front, and from then on, it's just as easy as white rice and comes out perfectly every time. I am not a morning person, and unfortunately, one of my children really likes sushi rice for breakfast with a fried egg on top. Since our town has a little bit of a crazy school bus schedule, she needs to be eating breakfast at 6:30 in the morning, and there is no way that I am waking up at 5:45 in the morning to make rice. But with Instant Pot, I don't have to. I get everything assembled the night before and tell it to start cooking in X number of hours, and then to keep it warm. How awesome is that? I can buy excellent yogurt without going through the trouble of making it. But I cannot buy excellent farmer's cheese. And to make farmer's cheese, you need to ferment milk just like you do for making yogurt. In my house, especially in winter, that is easier said than done because we keep our house very cold. That's where Instant Pot comes in. It gives me the ability to reliably ferment milk in 8 to 10 hours. Of course, it's just not a task that I do all that often, so I can't possibly see buying this appliance just for this task. But if this feature happens to be there, that's kind of nice. I'll tell you what, since I bought the Instant Pot, I've made way more farmer's cheese than I have ever made in my entire life. I don't use the slow cooker feature, so I have not tested that. It's basically the same as pressure cooker, only 10 times slower, so I really don't see the point. So we're gonna move on to the meat of the matter, pressure cooking. That's really why most people buy the Instant Pot. It's a pressure cooker, but it's not scary because it's not called a pressure cooker. Just to be clear, all modern pressure cookers have safety features that do not allow them to explode. So Instant Pot is not safer than the stovetop pressure cooker, but it is a lot more hands-off. You do not need to be home to turn down the heat and then turn it off. You press a few buttons and then you walk away. Instant Pot's pressure cooking forte are dishes that do not require a sear, have a very long cooking time, and a very flexible degree of doneness. Brown rice, polenta, and chicken stock all came out beautifully, and so much easier and more convenient than using traditional methods. I think chicken stock alone is worth buying the Instant Pot for. The dishes that I had the most trouble with were meat braises and beans. Meat braises and stews require you to brown the meat first, and browning meat in the Instant Pot is not easy. The surface area is small, the walls are tall, which traps the steam. The bottom of the pot is curved, so all the oil runs to the sides. And the heat turns down all by itself as soon as the Instant Pot thinks it's getting too hot. Yes, it's smart like that. My 6-quart Instant Pot only fits 3 chicken thighs at a time, and here is the best browning I could produce on them. Yep, it's a bit wimpy. My favorite braising pan fits 7 to 8 thighs and can put on a much better sear in less time. Also, consider the fact that your skillet sits on the stove under the hood, while the Instant Pot sits on the counter smoking up your ceiling and cabinets. Another problem that I have with Instant Pot when it comes to braisers applies to all pressure cookers, whether they are electric or stovetop. They are great at bringing meat to shreddable consistency way faster than traditional cooking methods and work well for dishes that do not have large quantity of stock or wine in the sauce. For example, pulled pork covered in barbecue sauce, or chili, or meatballs. Sure, for those, Instant Pot is your friend. But for dishes like ossobuco, or coq au vin, or boeuf bourguignon, not so much. And that's because these classic European braisers contain a very large quantity of wine and stock. In a normal pan, the stock would reduce and the alcohol would evaporate from the wine, producing very complex, mellow, and rich sauces, and allowing the top of the meat to get a bit toasty during 3 to 5 hours in the oven. In a pressure cooker, the sauce comes out watery and the meat comes out completely wet. Absolutely no crust on top of it. I've tried reducing the braising liquid before pressure cooking and after pressure cooking, and it's never quite the same as in a good Dutch oven. And my last but not least gripe with the Instant Pot is that it is not great at cooking beans, at least not all beans. Unlike the stovetop pressure cooker, which is fantastic at cooking all bean varieties. It's not just faster, it's like really the best way to cook beans. Instant Pot is very inconsistent. This actually caught me by surprise. I did not expect this. But now that I've done a lot of bean testing in the Instant Pot, it makes perfect sense. Most pressure cookers, both the stovetop and electric models like Instant Pot, have two pressure settings, high and low. The high on stovetop pressure cookers is roughly 15 psi, and the high on electric pressure cookers is roughly 12 psi. This info is easy to find online, and most websites will tell you to increase the cooking time slightly when using an electric pressure cooker because it's cooking at a slightly lower pressure. But it turned out that that advice can sometimes be misguided, because there is a much bigger difference between electric and stovetop pressure cookers than the pressure they're cooking at. And this difference is how quickly a pressure cooker can drop the pressure without opening the steam release valve. This dropping of pressure, because the pot drops in temperature, is called natural release. For some dishes, there is no harm in opening the steam release valve and dropping the pressure quickly. But for beans, that's a very risky maneuver. And that's because when you open the steam valve, the contents of the pot boil like crazy. And for delicate beans, that's a recipe for disaster. That can easily break them all up and produce a mush. So most bean recipes, whether they are for stovetop or electric pressure cookers, will recommend that you let the pressure drop naturally, do the natural release, do not open the steam valve. And that turned out to be trouble, because the Instant Pot is insulated. So it is very, very inefficient at dropping the pressure quickly. It took literally forever for the pressure to drop all by itself. So I cooked 1 pound of cannellini beans for 5 minutes on high pressure in both the Instant Pot and the stovetop pressure cooker. After 10 minutes of sitting off heat, my stovetop pressure cooker dropped the pressure completely. The Instant Pot didn't depressurize for a whole 35 minutes after the cooking time was up. And of course, that's an awful lot of extra cooking, and all my beans broke up. Equipped with this knowledge, I tried this test again, letting Instant Pot sit for 10 minutes after the cooking time was up and then releasing the rest of the pressure by opening the steam valve. That made the contents of the pot boil so much, the beans broke up just as badly. I called Instant Pot and they suggested that I put a cold wet towel on top of the pot to help it cool off faster. I tried that and even added some ice packs. Still, no luck. Yeah, the pressure dropped a little bit faster, but not faster enough, and my beans still broke up. I tried everything. I tried shorter cooking time. I even tried starting with unsoaked cannellini. Nothing worked. Either I got beans that were too hard, or I got a mush. Basically, cooking delicate beans in the Instant Pot is kind of like driving a car with no brakes. Sure, sometimes you'll get lucky and make a good guess about when to take the foot off the gas so that the car can just slow down to a stop at the right moment, but most of the time you'll guess wrong and produce disastrous results. To be fair, I picked the hardest bean test. Cannellini are notoriously difficult. Overcook them just a little, or let the water boil a bit too hard, and they turn to mush. But they are my gold standard of evaluating a bean cooking method. If it works on cannellini, it works on any bean. And Instant Pot does not work on any bean. But it does work for some beans. I made a fantastic black bean soup in the Instant Pot. No soaking, 30 minutes on high pressure, and natural release. Worked like a charm. All the beans were creamy, sure, some broke up a bit, but in a soup, it's not a biggie. So basically, if you stick to sturdy varieties like garbanzos, black beans, pintos, kidney beans, you'll be fine. And avoid those delicate white beans like cannellini, Great Northern, and navy. I would also suggest that you look up cooking procedures specifically designed for Instant Pot, because the stovetop pressure cooking times will be quite different. To sum it all up, Instant Pot offers a great way to cook the following stuff: stocks, grains, pulled pork, and sturdy beans. If you're trying to decide between buying the Instant Pot or a stovetop pressure cooker, it really boils down to how much you like beans. If you want the ability to cook absolutely any bean and do it perfectly, get a stovetop pressure cooker. If you're not a huge bean person, definitely get the Instant Pot. Sure, it can't cook every bean, but it is so much more convenient and flexible. Oh, and if you want to cook European classics like ossobuco and cassoulet, get a Dutch oven. What are your thoughts on Instant Pot? Do you have one? What do you use it for? Or maybe you found a great way to cook those annoying cannellini beans in Instant Pot? I would love to know your method, so leave me the comments below. I hope you found this video helpful. Here's some more cooking equipment videos for you. And if you are ever in the Boston area, maybe I'll see you in one of my classes.